energy and passion has been in the room. So we'll have a little bit of fun towards the end of the day on voting for some stuff and doing some cards. Brilliant. Helen, shall we get cracking?
Good evening, and it's fantastic to be here with you in Birmingham. And you know, what I want to talk about, my provocation, it's time to rewrite the rules of change in health and care. And I think, actually, new Health and Care Voices is really part, I think, of the new rules. I think that even 3 or 4 years ago, a group like this wouldn't have happened. You know, and it's the fact it is happening, and I think we're on the verge in terms of change, of some very new ways of thinking and very new ways of acting about change, and I'd like to talk about that tonight. So this is an art installation. We have a bit of an art thing on the top, and this comes from an installation artist called Adam Katz, and he took, you know, those little orange plastic soldiers. He took 25,000 of them, and he put them on a shop window, and it said, "All of my good ideas are battles." And you know, I've worked in health and care improvement for a very long time, 30 years, and you know, always been a change agent, always been an activist. And when I think that, my whole career has felt like that. You know, all my good ideas are battles, and like, I can remember. When I worked for the NHS Institute and with a couple of other people came up with this idea of let's do something called productive ward. And like nobody else would listen. And people said you can't do it because it isn't in the business plan. And so there wasn't any resources. So what we had to do was we had two like part-time temporary people working on this programme. And it was like, it just felt like such a battle to make this thing happen. And I was so convinced in my own mind that it would be a great thing. And you know, we ended up in a situation where, according to the official statistics from the now abolished Strategic Health Authorities of England, 78% of all the wards in hospitals in England adopted productive ward. I think some of them were a lot more successful than others. It got adopted in 44 territories around the world. And you know, we went on and we had productive community services, productive operating theatres, and productive general practice. But it wasn't like, it's like anything really that I think is new and innovative and different ways forward in change. I think it's always a battle. And this is a quote from Huxley, Thomas Huxley, who was an evolutionary biologist. And here he was writing about Darwin's theory of natural selection. And he said, "New truths begin as heresies." And I think actually the people in this room, the kind of people we are, you know, the activists, the people that will challenge the status quo, and the people that want a different future for our patients and service users, okay? You know, we're the heretics. And a lot of people don't want to hear the new truth that we're putting forward about how change has to happen in health and care. And I want to show you a new truth that's a heresy, okay? This comes from Gary Hamel. And one of the things about Gary Hamel is that apparently, according to the Financial Times, he's the number one business influencer in the world. Okay? So let's look at Gary Hamel's new truth. Am I okay standing here, or shall I go?
That's what places that I can put some lovely pictures on.
Okay. So when you look back in history, according to Gary Hamel, change always starts on the fringe or at the edge. And it always starts with the activists. And yet we work in organisations where people believe something fundamentally different. You know, we work in organisations where people think that change starts at the top. It starts with senior leaders, and if senior leaders don't buy into it, it's never going to happen. But that's not what history tells us. And I think now is the time for the people at the fringe, the activists, to be leading the kind of change that we want to see for our patients and service users. And, you know, the reason why I say this is because if we look around the world, okay, and like, it's great here, there's lots of people here I've kind of never met in person, but are my social media friends, and it's great to be here with you. And you know, when you look at what people are saying, okay, across the world, you know, the practitioners, the thought leaders, the futurists, about what is happening with regard to change, just change generally, whatever industry you look at, and people are saying pretty similar things about change. And what they're basically saying is there's a seismic shift going on in the way that we think about change and innovation in society. So the first thing that people say is that change is happening much, much more quickly. And instead of small-scale incremental improvement, we're seeing very big-scale disruptive change. The second thing that is happening, and we know that because I think just many of us sat here doing our little social media act, are living embodiment of this, just what a difference digital connection has made for us. And we can connect, every one of us, with virtually anybody in the developed world 24 hours a day with very little effort or at little cost. We're just connecting, we're sharing, we're knowledge gathering all the time. The third thing that's happening is that, like across the world, across multiple industries, work is getting more complex. Because the kind of jobs that people used to do in the past, you know, that were very conformist, were very repetitive, were very standardised, doesn't work in a new world. And, you know, healthcare's not the only industry, or health and care is not the only industry that this happens in. But, you know, any of us who work in hospital sector, when we look at the acuity, the sickness levels of our patients now compared to even 4 or 5 years ago, okay, you know, our work is so much more complex. The people that we work with every day have got, you know, more complex needs. Those of us that work in primary care or community services, you know, what do we see? We see that we're treating and supporting and caring for many people who even 4 or 5 years ago would have been cared for in a hospital sector. And there's a pretty fundamental consequence of the increasing complexity of work, which is that the levers of change, you know, the hierarchical systems that used to work in the past just aren't as effective anymore. Okay? The power of hierarchy is diminishing, and it's happening across the world, across multiple industries. And the final thing I wanted to talk about in this section is change is moving. Change is moving to the edge of organisations. You only have to look at big corporations. You know, what is happening with research and development functions in big corporate organisations? They're being moved from the centre of the organisation out to the edge. And the reason why is because big corporates know that in a world where change is happening more and more quickly, where in order to stay in front, you know, we have to innovate more disruptively, more quickly, that we need to be focusing our change both inside the organisation and out. We need to be looking outwards. So organisational development is looking outwards. The management of change is looking outwards. Innovation is looking outwards. So we have to move our change functions, you know, to the edge. And, you know, we can kind of laugh at this, but I think this is true of a lot of healthcare organisations. You know, instead of risking anything new, let's play it safe by continuing our slow decline into obsolescence. So, some of you have seen this before, and if you've seen it, it's kind of reinforcement, okay? But this was kind of like trying to get on one page, kind of my synopsis of what I think is happening in the world of change as a general direction. And what I'm doing here is contrasting what I'm calling the dominant approach with an emerging direction. I just want to really quickly just take you through them both. But before I do that, there's a kind of health warning with this, okay? We're not saying that it's from to, okay? Because this dominant approach is alive and kicking and will continue to be so. But we, as the kind of change agents and activists, we need to be operating in that very difficult, zigzaggy place in the middle. So let's just look at this. So in the dominant approach, power comes through hierarchy, okay? The people with the power are the people with positional authority. And in the emerging direction, power comes through connection. You know, it's where we are in the network, who we're connecting with, who we can influence. And actually, power is very little to do with organisational status at all. In the dominant approach, we'd look at the mission and vision of the organisation. You know, and again, it's really important that we're doing this, and we work for organisations where that mission and vision is very clear, and we can march behind it. But in this world, we focus on shared purpose. because we have a very different relationship with our patients, with our communities, and with our partners. The kind of change that we're talking about in health and care across sectors means that we can't contain it in a single organisation anymore. So we have to put a huge effort into building shared purpose with other people. In this world, we talk about making sense through rational argument, you know, data-driven change, effective planning processes, program management systems. Whereas here, we make sense through emotional connection. You know, we build that shared purpose and we connect on the level of emotions and values. When I went to improvement school in the NHS, which was quite a long time ago, you know, one thing I was taught was that if I wanted to influence a medical doctor to change, I had to show him or her a graph. Okay, because what I was told is that if you want to influence a medic, you have to show them data. And you know, it's not true. Even medical doctors are far more likely to be influenced to change because we connect at that level of emotion and values than because we show data. I mean, obviously, we want the best of both worlds, don't we? We want to have some really compelling data, but we need to be wrapping story and call to action around it. Here, innovation is leadership driven, you know, down from the top of the organisation. See this often in the hospital sector, where the chief exec will say, we need to take £100 million out of our budget baseline, so we're going to have an innovation programme to involve everybody to get your good ideas. But it's very much driven from the top. But here, it's viral. You know, it's the ideas are coming from where the action happens of care. It's that kind of creativity. Here, the methods are tried and tested, you know, based on experience. And this is my background as an improvement person in the NHS. So honestly, if there was like Mastermind on Six Sigma, Lean, and Total Quality Management, I tell you what, I'd get 16 out of 16. You know, I can do this stuff. But you see, the world is changing. And it's becoming so much more open. And we're connecting with different people. We're sharing ideas, comparing data, co-creating change. This really came home to me quite recently because, you know, like, people kind of like put me on this pedestal and say I'm an expert on improvement. And I kind of don't really like being that, but kind of a lot of people need me to be that. So I kind of like think, well, if you need me to be that, I'll be that, you know. Some of you actually were part of our school. Who was in our school? The School for Health and Care Radicals. There's some people here. Yeah, fantastic. So we decided we wanted to do a virtual graduation ceremony for the School for Health and Care Radicals, which was this virtual school that we ran for change agents. So, because like we're creative in our team, and we decided that we had people from 40 countries taking part in this virtual school for health and care radicals. So we were going to do this virtual graduation ceremony. So we had the bright idea of running it in Second Life, so that all the people that were graduating would be avatars. And we'd kind of like do this amazing virtual graduation where all the, you know, the graduates would get their certificates, their graduation certificates as avatars. Great idea. The only problem was that when we tried to get like permission to do this on the NHS computer system, you know, you would thought that we were like you know, the biggest threat to computer security in the history of the NHS. So we haven't managed to do it yet, but we are going to do it. Just might take us a year or two. On this side, you know, it's transactional, okay? This is about holding people to account for performance. It's about compliance. It's about regulation. It's about inspection. You know, we hold people to account on a transactional basis. This side, it's about relationships. It's relational. On this side, we're doing change and we're engaging change because we want to. You know, every one of us is here tonight because we want to be here, not because we have to be here. And I say this is the way that the world is going. The reality is, I mean, I get to work with lots and lots of NHS organisations, health and care organisations. I get to look at lots of Better Care Fund applications and Transformation Board plans and proposals. Okay? And what we see is that whilst our aspirations are, you know, very transformational and radical, actually, the way that we're seeking to go about change is in a left-handed way, very typically. And it's almost like there's become this almost like program management industry. You know, in a sense where we're working with big, complex changes for integrated care, for working with frail older people, across the whole system. What do we do? We try and minimise risk, and we try and manage things very objectively and hold people to account through kind of work streams, okay? The reality is, if you look at the history of large-scale change and those leaders of systems and communities and organisations that have been able to deliver at the kind of scale that we're seeking in health and care, we start from this side. And if we can build meaning in this way, if we can build shared purpose, actually we can do compliance without even trying, because people understand why we're doing it. I just like to have a little bit of drama. Okay, so I like this one. This comes from Maddie Grant, and she says, "We are on a collision course between the new organic human-focused forces of social media and the machine world of our organisations." And I think, potentially there's a train crash coming. We'll see. And that's why, people like us, I think, are coming of age in this era. Because, this is no longer a time for conformance and compliance and yes people. Okay? This is a time in the history of the health and care system for radical thinkers, for disruptive innovators, for mavericks, for rebels. Because these are the people in our organisations who are going to question existing ideas, who are going to open up new ideas for action. And actually, the kind of people we are, I'd say, I put it strongly to say we're the kind of the champions, and we're the best hope of the health and care system moving forward with the people that we connect with. And we need to be rebels. I took this from this really beautiful 200 slide share, okay, by one of my Twitter friends, Peter Van. 200 beautiful slides talking about being an organisational rebel. And he says, what's a rebel? Somebody who's the champion of a change initiative, a cause, or an action. And the thing about rebels don't wait for permission to do what they're told. They kind of get on with it. They lead, they innovate, they strategize. But the thing about rebels is that they're not, crazy Exocet missiles going around creating chaos all over the place. They're responsible. They do what is right, because they are, the biggest champions of the patient or person-centered mission of our organizations and systems. Okay. They name things that other people just don't see yet. Okay. They point to new horizons, new possibilities, hope, different futures. And I think this is probably my favourite quote about rebels. Without rebels, the storyline never changes. Without people that are willing to stand up and question the status quo and do things in different ways, the storyline never changes. And our storyline in health and care has to change. So, two more slides. Okay. Just an advert, just to say, the day after tomorrow, my little team in NHS Improving Quality, we're launching a new hub, and it's a virtual hub, and it's a knowledge hub for people in health and care who want to connect with, I think, hand-picked ideas and knowledge and research. Ideas and knowledge to kind of stimulate us and keep us on the same track. And the great thing about this, the edge, is that it also connects us. It isn't enough to have the knowledge. We also need to have the connection. And anybody that wants to sign up for it is theedge.nhsiq.nhs.uk. But what I want to do, I think, to end with, is to make a connection between the kind of stuff we do, okay, and virtual stuff, and the real importance of social movements like New Health and Care Voices. And I just wanted to show you an interesting statistic, which is my final point. So, we need to spread new knowledge, new ways of thinking, new activities, new practice for change. What's the best way of doing that? If we make social connections and discussions like we are tonight, we learn from each other, okay? It's 14 times more effective than any toolkit or best practice database or written down thing. So I think we need things like The Edge, because it connects us
with the best knowledge around change and transformation, and helps to keep us on the road at moving forward. But we really need things and opportunities to connect, like New Health and Care Voices, because I'd say that coming together like this and learning from each other, I think is and connecting and supporting each other. You know, we have a hard job ahead as change agents in health and care, challenging the status quo, showing that there could be a different way, igniting the fire of change. It's a really, really tough job. And we need each other to be able to do that. So thank you.
Thank you.